heaven admits no jest. What's the presumed on which too much by striving how to prove there was no God, with foolish grounds of art discovered first the nearest way to hell, and filled the world with devilish atheism? Such questions youth are fond. Far better 'tis to bless the sun than reason why it shines. Yet he thou talkest of is above the sun. No more! I may not hear it.
But, gentle father, to you I have unclasped my burdened soul, emptied the storehouse of my thoughts and mind, made myself poor of secrets, and spoke all's which I dare think and know. And yet here is the comfort I shall have. Must I not do what all men else may, and love?
Yes, yes, you may love, fair son.
Must I not praise that beauty, which if framed anew, the gods would make a god of, and kneel to it as I kneel to them?
Why, foolish madman!
Shall a peevish sound, or a customary form of man to man, be a bar twixt my perpetual happiness and me? Say we had one father, say one womb cares to my joys. Are we therefore not to each other so much more bound by the links of reason and of nature, even if you will have it of religion, to be ever one, one flesh, one heart, one soul, and one all?
Have done, unhappy youth, for thou art lost.
Shall then my joys be ever banished from her bed, for I am her brother born? In your eyes I see the change of pity and compassion as a sacred oracle distills the life of counsel. But tell me, friar, what cure shall give me ease in these extremes?
Repentance, son, and sorrow for this sin, but thou hast moved a majesty above with thy unranged, almost blasphemy.
Do not speak of that, dear confessor.
Art thou my son? That miracle of wit, who once within these 3 months was to esteem the wonder of thine age throughout Benonia. How did the university applaud thy government, behaviour, learning, speech, sweetness, and all that can make up a man? I was proud of my tutelage, and I chose rather to leave my books than to part with thee. I did so, but the fruits of all my hopes are lost in thee as thou art in thyself. O Giovanni, hast thou left the schools of knowledge to converse with lust and death? For death waits on thy lust. Look through the world, and thou shalt see 1,000 faces shine more glorious than this idol thou adorest. Leave her, and take thy choice. 'Tis much less sin, though in such games as those, they lose but win.
It were more ease to stop the ocean from floats and ebbs than to dissuade my vows.
Then I have done, and in thy willful flames already see thy ruin. Heaven is just. Yet hear my counsel.
As a voice of life.
Hide to thy father's house. There lock thee fast alone in thy chamber, and fall down on both thy knees. Grovel on the ground, cry to thy heart, wash every word thou utterest in tears, and if be possible of blood, beg heaven to cleanse the leprosy of lust that rots thy soul. Acknowledge what thou art, a wretch, a worm, and nothing. Weep, sigh, pray, 3 times a day and 3 times every night. For 7 days' space do this. Then if thou find'st no change in thy desires, return to me. I'll think on remedy. Pray for thyself at home whilst I pray for thee here. Away! My blessing is with thee. We have need to pray.
All's this I'll do to free me from the rod of vengeance. Else I'll swear my face, my God.
Come, sir, stand to your tackling. If thou prove craven, I'll make thee run quickly.
Thou art no equal match for me.
Indeed, I never went to wars to bring home news, nor can I play them out back for a meal's meat. I swear you, I got my wounds in the field. See you, these grey hairs will not flinch for a bloody nose. Wilt thou to this gear?
My slave, think'st thou I'll balance my reputation with a cast sweet? Call thy master. He shall know that I
scored like a cock queen, that's your profession. I'll bore shadow of a soldier. I'll make thee know my mask keeps servants thy better in quality and performance. Come, sir, fight or prit.
Neither with thee, for I am a Roman and a gentleman, one that have earned mine honor with expense of blood.
You're a lying coward and a fool. Fighter, by these hilts I kill thee.
Provoke me not, sir, for if thou dost...
Have I...
What mean these sudden broils so near to my doors? Have you not other places but my house to vent the spleen of your disordered bloods? Must I be haunted with such unrest as not to eat or sleep in peace at home? Is this your love, Grimaldi? Fie, it is not.
And there's Quez. I may tell thee, 'tis not well to broach these quarrels. You are ever forward in seconding contentions.
What's the ground?
That, with your patience, Señor Madame, I'll resolve. This gentleman, who fame reports, a soldier, for else I know not, rivals me in love to Señor Florio's daughter, to whose ears he still prefers a suit to my disgrace, thinking the way to recommend himself is to disparage me in his report. But no, Grimaldi, though maybe thou art my equal in thy blood, yet all this be raised in thy lowest mind, which, with thou noble, thou wardest as much disdain, as I do thee for this witness. And on this ground, I willed my servant to correct his tongue, holding a man so base, no match for me.
And had not your sudden coming prevented us, I'd have let my gentleman blood beneath the gills. I should have wormed you, sir, for running mad.
I'll be revenged, Sir Anzo.
On a dish of warm broth to stay your stomach through, honest innocence, do. Spoon meat is a wholesomer diet than a Spanish blade.
Remember this.
I fear thee not, Grimaldi.
My lord Sir Anzo, this is strange to me. Why you should storm having my word engaged? Owing her heart, what need you doubt her ear? Losers may talk by law of any gain.
And yet, the villainy of words, Señor Florio, may be enough to turn an unspleened dove choleric. Blame not my lord in this.
You more silent! I would not for all my wealth my daughter's love should cause the spilling of one drop of blood! Vasquez, put up! Come! Let's end this fray in wine!
That Mars is standing upright. He crinkled so much in the hands. But you take a husband, as he is a plain, sufficient, naked man. Such a one is for your bed, and such a one is Signor Soranzo at Milan for it.
Sure, the woman took her morning's draught too soon.
Ooh, but look what comes now, sweetheart. Here's another one of the ciphers to fill up the number. Oh, brave old Open a silk. I say.
Didst thou think, Portia, that I would spoil my new clothes and leave my dinner?
No, sir, I do not take you false, O arrant, a baby.
I am wiser than so far, I hope, Portia. Thou never heard'st of an elder brother was coxcomb. Dis Portia?
No, not unless they have land or money left for us to inherit.
Oh. Is it possible, Portia? Oh, monstrous! Why, I'll undertake with a handful of silver to buy a headful of wit at any time. But, Sarah, I have another purchase in hand. I shall have the wench, mine aunt says. I will but wash my face and shift socks and patter, I faith. Mark my pace, Portia.
Sir, I've seen an ass and a mule trot the Spanish pavern of Margaret's. I don't know how many times.
This idiot haunts me too.
Aye, he needs no description. The rich magnifico that was below with your father charge, Madame Donardo, his auntie. For that means to make this his cousin a golden calf, thinks that you will be a right Israelite and bow to him presently. But I'll have tutored you better. They say a fool's baubles are a lady's playfellow. Yet you haven't wealth enough, you not cast upon the dearth of flesh. At any rate, hang him innocent.
Gitana, see, oh, what blessed shape of some celestial creature now appears. What man is he that with such shared aspect walks careless of himself? Where? Look below.
It's your brother, sweet. No, it's your brother.
Sure, 'tis not he. This is some woeful thing wrapped up in grief, some shadow of a man. Alas, he beats his breast and wipes his eyes, drowned all in tears. Oh, methinks I hear him sigh. Oh, let's down, Gitana, and partake the cause. Oh, I know my brother, and the love he bears me will not deny me partage in his sadness.
Lost. I am lost. My fates have doomed my death. The more I strive, I love. The more I love, the less I hope. I see my ruin certain. What judgment or endeavors could apply to my incurable and restless wounds? Oh, that it were not in religion. Sin to make our love a god and worship it. I have wearied the heaven with prayers, dried up the springs with my continual tears, starved my veins with daily fasts. What wit or art could counsel I have practiced. But alas, I find all this but old men's tales to fright unsteady youth. And she is one to me, or I must speak or burst, and I'll tell her I love her. 'Tis not my lust that leads me on. Heaped fear with low, faint-hearted shame with slaves, though it were rated at the price of that attempt. O me, she comes home.
Brother?
If such a thing as courage dwell in men, you double all that virtue in my tongue.
Why, brother, will you not speak to me?
Yes. How do you, sister?
however I am, methinks you are not well. Oh, bless us! Why are you so sad?
Let me entreat you. Leave us a while.
Sister, may I be private with you?
Withdraw, Titana.
If this were any other company for her, I should think my absence an office of some credit. But I will leave them alone together.
Come, sister, lend your hand. I hope you need not blush to walk with me. Here's none but you and I.
How's this?
Faith, I mean no harm.
Harm?
No, how is it with you?
I trust he be not frantic. I am very well, brother.
Trust me, but I am sick, so sick I fear it will cost my life.
Mercy forbid it. 'Tis not so, I hope.
I think you love me, sister.
Yes, you know I do.
I know it indeed. You are very fair.
Nay, then I see you have a merry sickness.
That's as it proves. The poet's fain, I read, that Juno, for her forehead, did exceed all other goddesses. But I dare say your forehead exceeds hers, as hers did theirs.
Troth, this is pretty.
Such a pair of stars that thine eyes would, like Promethean fire, if gently glanced, give life to a senseless stone.
Fie upon you.
The lily and the rose, most sweetly strange, do strive upon your dimpled cheeks for change. Such lips as those would tempt a saint, and such hands as those would make an anchorite lascivious.
Do you mock me or flatter me?
Here.
What to do?
And here's my breast. Rip up my bosom, and in which is a heart, in which is writ the truth I speak.
Are you earnest?
Yes, most earnest. You cannot love.
Who?
Me. My tortured soul hath felt affliction in the heat of death. Annabella, I am quite undone. The view of thee and the love of thy immortal beauty have untuned all harmony in my rest and life. Why do you not strike?
Forbid it. My just fears, if this be true, to a fitter I would die.
True. Annabella, 'tis no time to jest. I have too long suppressed the hidden flames that have almost consumed me, reasoned against the reasons of my love. 'Tis my destiny that you must love, or I must die.
Oh, comes this in sadness from you?
Let some mischief befall me soon, before I dissemble aught.
You are my brother, Giovanni.
And you are my sister, Annabella. I know this, and why could afford you so much instance in which wise nature first in your creation meant to make you mine? Else through sin and foul, to share double a beauty, to one a soul, affecting a nearest in affection. And I have asked counsel of the Holy Church, who tells me I may, and that since I may love you, I will. Yes, I will love you. Must I now live or die?
Live! Thou hast won the field and never fought. What thou hast erred, my captive heart had long ago resolved. Oh, I blush to tell thee, but I'll tell thee now, for every sigh thou hast spent for me, I have sighed 10, for every tear shed 20, and not so much for that I loved, but that I durst not say I loved, nor scarcely think it.
Let not this music be a dream, ye gods, for pity's sake, I beg.
On my knees, brother, even by our mother's dust, I charge you, do not betray me to your mirth or hate. Love me or kill me, brother.
On my knees, sister, even by our mother's dust, I charge you, do not betray me to your mirth or hate. Love me or kill me, sister.
You mean
good seed,
then?
In good troth I do, and so do you, I hope. Say I'm in earnest.
I swear it. I.
And I am this kiss. Once more. Yeah, once more. Now let's rise. I wouldn't change this moment for all of Elysium. What must we now do?
Oh, what you will.
Come then, as we have spent so many nights in sighs and tears, let's learn to kiss and sleep.
Madame Donardo, I understand you well, but would have you know I will not force my daughter against her will. You see, I have but two, a son and her, and he is so devoted to his book, I must tell you true, I doubt his health. Should he miscarry, all my hopes rely upon the girl. As for worldly fortune, I thank my stars, blessed with enough. My care is how to match her to a liking. I would not have her marry wealth, but love. And if she like your nephew, well, let him have her. Here's all that I can say.
Sir, you say well, like a true father. And for my part, I, if the young folks can like, twixt you and me, promise to assure my nephew presently 3,000 florins yearly during life and after I am dead. My whole estate.
Tis a fair proffer, madame. Meantime, your nephew shall have free passage to commence his suit. If he can thrive, he shall have my consent. But for now, I leave you, madame.
My nephew would have wit. But he is such another dunce, I fear he'll never win the wench. When I was young, I could have durned, I think. And so shall he, if he will learn of me. And in good time, he comes himself. How now, Brigetto? Whither away so fast?
Oh, Aunt, I've heard the strangest news that ever came out of the mint, have I not, Poggio?
Yes, indeed, sir.
What news, Brigetto?
Why, look ye, Aunt. My barber told me just now that there is a fellow come to town who undertakes to make a mill go without more help than water or wind, only with sandbags. This fellow has a strange horse. A most excellent beast, I'll assure you, Aunt. My barber says, whose head is the wonder of all Christian people stands to the pine road? Hey, it is! It's not you, Poggio!
So the barber swore forsooth.
And you are running thither?
Aye, forsooth, Aunt.
Wilt thou be a fool still? Come, sir, you shall not go. You have more mind of a puppet play than of the business I told you. Why, thou great baby, wilt never have wit. Wilt make thyself a main game to all the world?
Answer for yourself, master.
Why, Aunt, should I sit at home still and not go abroad to see fashions like other gallants?
To see hobby horses? What wise talk, I pray. Had you with Annabella when you were at Signor Florio's house?
The wench! What say, Aunt? I tickled her with a rare piece that made her almost burst her belly with laughing.
Nay, I think so. And what speech was it?
What did I say, Poggio?
Forsooth, my master said that he loved her almost as much as he loved his parmesan, and he wants to. But such a nose as hers was to be prettier than any other girl in all of Parma.
Oh, gross.
Nay, aunt, then she asked whether my father had more children than myself. I said no, to whether he should have knocked his brains out first.
This is intolerable.
Then said she, will Madame Donato, your aunt, leave you all her wealth?
Huh. That was good. And did she harp upon that string?
Did she harp upon that string? Aye, that she did. I answered, leave me all her wealth. Why, woman, she had no other wit. If she had, she should hear unto her everlasting glory and confusion. I know, quoth I am her white boy and will not be caught. And with that she fell into a great smile, whoop, and went away. Nay, I did fit her.
Sirrah, then I see there is no changing of nature. Well, Bajetto, I fear thou art a very ass still.
I should be sorry for that, aunt.
Come, come you home with me. Since you are no better a speaker, I shall have you write to her after some courtly manner and enclose some rich jewelry in the letter.
Aye, marry, that would be excellent.
Peace. Innocent. Once in my time, I'll set my wits to school. If all fail, it is but the fortune of a fool.
Poggio, twill do, Poggio.
Come, Annabella, no more sister now, but love, a name more gracious. Blush not, beauty's sweet wonder, but know that yielding hath conquered and inflamed the heart in which is thy brother's life.
And mine is his. Oh, how these stolen contents would print a modest crimson on my cheeks, had any but my heart's delight prevailed.
I marvel why the chaster of your sex should think this pretty toy called maidenhead so strange a loss, when being lost is nothing and you are still the same.
'Tis well for you. Now you can talk.
Music consists as well in the playing as in the ears.
Oh, you are wanton. Tell aunt, you were best. Do.
Thou wilt chide me then, so kiss me. And so hung Jove, and quick, kiss sweet Leda's neck, and suck divine ambrosia from her lips. I envy not the mightiest man alive, but hold myself in being king of thee. But I must lose you.
But you shall not.
You must be married, mistress.
Yes? To whom?
Someone must have you.
You must?
Nay, some other.
Now, prithee, do not speak so. Without jesting, you'll make me weep in earnest.
What? You will not. But canst thou be dead, thou wilt swear to live to me and no other.
By both our loves, I dare. But didst thou know, my Giovanni, how all suitors seem to my eyes hateful. Thou wouldst trust me then?
Enough. take thy word for it. Remember what thou hast vowest.
Will you be gone?
I must.
When to return?
Soon.
Look, you do.
Farewell.
Go where thou wilt. In my mind, I'll keep thee here. And where thou art, I know I shall be there. Guardian!
Child! Child. How is it? Thank heaven.
Oh, guardian, what a paradise of joy have I passed over.
Nay, what a paradise of joy you have passed under. Why, now I commend thee, sweetheart. Fear nothing. What though he be your brother? Your brother's a man, I hope. And I still say, if the young wench feel a fit upon her, let her take anybody. Father, brother, all in one.
I would not have it known for all the world.
Nor I.
Speech of people. Else it were nothing.
Daughter Annabella!
Me! My father! Here, sir! Reach my work!
What are you doing?
So let him come now!
So hard at work! That's well, you lose no time. But look, I have brought you company. Here's one, a learned doctor. Lately come from Padua, much skilled in physic, and I see for that you have of late been sickly. I entreated this reverend man come visit you sometime.
You are very welcome, sir.
I thank you, mistress. Loud fame and large report have spoken your praise, for which I brought you a kinswoman of mine, a maid for song and music. See you to know her.
Oh, they are parts I love. And she for them most welcome. Thank you, kindly.
Sir, now you know my house, pray you not make strange. And if you find my daughter need your art, I'll be your paymaster.
Sir, what I am, she shall command.
You shall bind me to you. Daughter, I must have conference with you about some matters that concern us both. Good master doctor, please, you would walk in. We'll crave a little of your cousin's cunning. I think my daughter hath not quite forgotten how to touch an instrument. Although she could have done it, you know. We'll hear them both.
I'll wait upon you, sir.
Love's measure is the extreme. The comfort pain, the life from rest, and the reward disdain. What here? Look to again, 'tis so. So writes this moves and sentence poets in his rhymes. But, Zanazar, thou liest, for had thy bosom felt such oppression as laid is on mine. Thou wouldst have kissed the rod that made thee smart to work. Then happy muse, and contradict what Zanazar had envy writ. Love's measure is the mean, sweet his annoys, his pleasures light, and his reward all joys. Had Annabella lived when Zanazar did, he must be with Pomium, celebrate Venice, that queen of cities. He left the verse which gave him such a sum of gold, and, for one only look from Annabella, he had writ of her, and her diviner cheeks. Oh, how my thoughts are...
Pray for Bear. In real civility, let me give notes on to have attached legends of duty and service.
What rude intrusion interrupts my peace? Can I be no private?
Trust, you do wrong your modesty.
And what's the matter, Pasquez? Who is it?
Man, on her whom thou and thy distracted lusts have wronged. Thy saturated blood hath made my youth a scorn to men and angels. And shall I now be a foil to thy instated change? Thou knowest, false wanton, when my modest fame stood free from stain or scandal, all the charms of hell or sorcery could not prevail against the honor of my chaste bosom. Thine eyes did see in tears, thy tongue and oaths, such and so many that a heart of steel would have wrought to pity, as was mine. And shall the conquest of my lawful bed, my husband's death, urged on by his disgrace, my lost womanhood be ill rewarded with hatred and contempt? No! Distaste the slavery of fearing thee as thou doth loathe the memory of what hath passed.
Nay, dear Hippolyta,
call me not dear, nor think with subtle words to smooth the grossness of my abuses. Tis not your new mistress, your godly madam merchant, shall triumphant on my dejection. Tell her thus from me, my birth was nobler and much more free.
You are too violent.
And you, and too double in your dissimulation, seest thou this habit, these black mourning weeds of care, thou art cause of this, and has made me a widow in my widowhood.
Will you yet hear
more of thy perjuries? Thy soul is drowned too deeply in thy sins. Thou needst not add to thy number.
Then I'll leave you. You have passed all rules of sense.
And thou art of grace!
Madam, if my lord has resolution as noble as virtue itself, you take course to an edge at all. Sir, I beseech you not perplex. Our last griefs will have met. I dare say, Madam Hippolyta will now freely talk to you.
Talk to woman frantic? Are these the fruits of your love?
Be the fruits of thy untruth, false man! I would wish no happiness more on earth than to call me wife. Did thou not vow when he should die to marry me, that the devil in my blood and thy protest cause me to counsel him to undertake a voyage to Linjore? For we heard his brother there was dead, and left a daughter, young and unfriended, whom, with much ado, I wished him to bring hither. He did so, and went, and died all the way. I'm the happy man to buy his death so dear. Yet thou behooves I did it, forgets thy vows, and leaves me to my
Who could help this?
Who? Perjured man. Thou couldst, if thou had faith or love. You are deceived.
vows I made, if you remember well, were wicked and unlawful. It were more sin to keep them than to break them. As for me, I cannot mask my penitence. Think thou how much is this crest upon a shame in bringing a gentleman to death? Who was thy husband such one as he? So noble in his quality, his condition, learning, behavior, entertainment, love as bomb, I can assure a braver man.
You do not well, this is not your promise.
I care not. Let him know a monstrous life. Here, how he's about so black a sin, I'll be accursed. Woman! Come here no more. Learn to repent and die by my honor. I hate thee in thy lust. You have been too foul.
Well, this part's been scurvily played.
How foolishly this beast contemns his faith and shuns the use of that which I more scorn than I once loved. His love. But let him go. My vengeance shall give comfort to his woe.
Your mistress, Madam Apollo, to pray a word or two.
With me, sir.
With you, if you please.
What is?
I know you're infinitely moved now, and you believe you have cause. Some, I admit, you have, but not nearly as much as you imagine.
Indeed.
No, you were miserably bitter, which you followed to the last syllable, but by my troth, you couldn't have caught my lord at a worse day since I knew him. Tomorrow you should find him a new man.
Well, I shall wait his leisure.
Fie, this is not a heart of patience. Come sourly from you. Troth, let me persuade you for once.
I have it, and so it shall be. Thanks, opportunity. Persuade me to what?
Visit him at some milder temper. Or if you can master a little of your feminine spleen, how might you win him?
He will never love me, Vasquez. Thou hast been too trusty servant to such a master, and I fear the reward in the end will fall out like mine.
So perhaps too.
Resolve thyself it will. Had I one so true, so truly honest, so secret to my counsels as thou hast been to him and his, I shall see it as a slight acquaintance, and not only make him master to all I have, but even to myself.
Now you are a noble gentlewoman.
Well, thou always feed upon hopes. I know thou art wise and seize the reward in an old servant daily. What is?
Beggary and neglect.
True, but Vasquez, where thou art mine will be private to me and my designs. I hereby protest myself, and all else I could call mine shall be at thy dispose.
Work you that way, old mole. And I have wind of you. I were not worthy of it. Would any desert that could lie within my compass if I could?
What then?
I should hope to live out these my old years in rest and security.
Give me thy hand, and promise both thy silence and here, in sight of heaven, that being done, and make thee lord to me and mine estate.
Come, you are merry. To such happiness I can neither think or believe.
Promise thy secrecy, and 'tis confirmed.
Then here I call upon the good genie for witness, that whatsoever your designs are, or whosoever against, I not only play a special act of therein, but never disclose it until it be effected.
I take thy word for it, and with that, thee for mine. Come then, let's more confer of this anon. On this delicious bane my thoughts shall banquet. Revenge shall sweeten what my griefs have tasted.
Thou seest, my lovely niece, These strange mishaps. How all my fortunes turn to my disgrace. Wherein I am but as a looker on. And whilst others act on my shame, I am silent.
But uncle, wherein can this borrowed shape give you content?
Oh, I'll tell thee, gentlemen, sir. Thy wanton hand, Hippolyta, in a lascivious riot, is now secure. Thinks I am surely dead in my late journey to Lejeune for you. Now, would I see with what an impudence she gives scope to her loose adultery and allows the common voice hereof? Thus far I prevail.
Alas, I fear you mean some strange revenge.
Fear not, your impudence shall plead you in awe. Up to our business. You've learned for certain how Signor Florio means to give his daughter in marriage to Soranzo?
Yes, for certain.
Yes, but how'd you find young Manuel's love inclined to him?
For aught I could perceive, she neither fancies him or any else.
There's mystery in that which time must show. She used you kindly?
Yes.
And craved your company?
Often.
Tis well. Goes as I could wish. I am the doctor now. And as for you, well, no one knows you. If all fail not, we shall thrive. Oh, but who comes here?
Oh.
Tis Grimaldi, a Roman and a soldier, one near alike to the Duke of Monteferrato, and a nuncio for Pope that now resides in Parma, by which means he hopes to get the fair love of Annabella.
Save you, sir.
And you, sir.
I have heard of your approved skill, which through the city is freely talked of, and would crave your aid.
For what, sir?
Marry, sir. But for this I would speak in private.
Leave us. Oh, cousin.
I love fair Annabella, and would know whether in arts there may not be receipts to move affection.
Sir, perhaps you may, but these will nothing profit you.
Why me?
Unless I be mistook, you are a man greatly in favour with the friar.
What of that?
Well, in duty to her grace, I'll be bold to tell you. If you want to find the love of fair Annabella, you must first remove the bar twixt you and her.
And who's that?
Soranzo is the man that hath their heart.
Woo! Soranzo? What mine enemy is it he?
Oh, is he your enemy?
The man I hate more than confusion. I'll end him.
Nay, then take mine advice. I'll find a time when he and she do meet, of which I'll give you notice. Be sure he shall not escape you. I'll provide poison to take on your rapier's point. If he has as many heads as a hydra, he dies.
Why? But... shall I trust thee, doctor?
As yourself, thou not in aught. Thus shall the fates decree. By me, Soranzo falls. That ruined me.
Well, sir, I must be content on being both your... and your messenger myself. I cannot tell thee what this letter may work, but as sure as I am alive, if thou will come once to talk with her, I fear thou will mar whatsoever I make.
You make, aunt? Why am I not big enough to carry mine own letter, I pray?
Aye, carry a fool's head of thy own. Why, thou dunce, wouldst thou write thy letter and carry it thyself?
Yes, that I would, and read it to her mind her mouth. But you must think if she will not believe me myself when she hears me speak. She will not believe another's handwriting. I am not a blockhead, aunt. Poggio knows I have indited a letter myself, so I have.
Yes, indeed, sir. I have it in my pocket.
Oh, a sweet one, no doubt. Pray, let's see it.
I cannot read my own hand very well. Poggio, read it, Poggio.
Begin.
Most dainty and honey-sweet mistress, I could call you fair, and lie as many that loves you. But mine auntie, being the older woman that she is, I leave it to her as more comforting to her age and the colour of her beard. And wise enough to bold where I see occasion. And if you like mine auntie's wit better than mine, then you shall marry me. If you like my wit better than hers, then I shall marry you, in spite of your teeth. Condemning my best parts to you, upwards, downwards, or you may choose.
Stuff, aunt!
Here is stuff indeed! To shame us all! Pray, whose advice did you take in this learned letter?
None word but upon my own.
And mine, aunt, believe it. T'was nobody else's. T'was mine own brain. I thank a good wit for it.
Get you home, sir. And look, you keep within doors until I return.
How? That were a jest indeed. I scorn it, I faith.
What? You do not.
Judge me, but I do now.
'Tis very unhealthy, sir.
Well, if I hear any of your apish running to motions and fopperies till I come back, you would as good not look to it.
Poggio shall still see the horse with the head where its tail is.
Aye, aye, but you must take heed of whippings.
Camest to me. Oh, young man, cast away by the religious number of mine order. I day and night have waited my aged eyes above my strength to weep on thy behalf. But heaven is angry, and be thou resolved. Thou art a man remarked to taste a mischief. Though it come late, it will come sure.
Friar, in this you are uncharitable. What I have done, I'll prove both fit and good. Tis principle which you taught when I was yet your scholar, that the frame and composition of the mind doth match the frame and composition of the body. So where the body's furniture is beauty, the mind's must needs be virtue. And virtue itself is reason, but refined, and love the quintessence of that.
Oh, ignorance and knowledge! Long ago, how often have I warned thee this before? Indeed, if we were sure that there were no deity, nor heaven, nor hell, then to be led alone by nature's light, as were philosophers of elder times, might instance some defense. But 'tis not so. Then, madman, thou wilt find that nature is in heaven's positions blind.
Your age overrules you. Had you youth like mine, you'd make her love your heaven and her divine.
Nay, then I see thou art too far sold to hell. It lies within the compass of my prayers to call thee back. Yet let me counsel thee. Persuade thy sister to some marriage.
Marriage? Why, that's to damn her.
That's to prove her greedy of variety and lust.
Oh, fearful, if thou would not, then give me leave to shrive her, lest she should dine absolved.
At your best leisure, father. View. Hear her but speak. View well her face, and every portion of that throne, and you will see for colour, lips, for eyes, jewels, for sweet perfumes, her breath, for delicious choice of flowers, her cheeks. Wonder in every portion of that throne. Hear her but speak, and you will swear that the spheres make music to the citizens in heaven.
The more I hear, I pity thee the more, that one so excellent should give those parts all to a second death. What I can do is but to pray, and yet I could advise thee if thou wouldst be ruled.
In what?
Why, leave her yet. The throne of mercy is above your trespass, yet time is left you both.
To embrace each other, else let all time be struck quite out of number. She is like me, and I like her resolve.
No more! I'll visit her. Oh, this grieves me most. Thus being thus, a pair of souls are lost.
That's a blessed soul, soul made up of holiness. I hope she'll teach him how to gain another world.
Fair gentlewoman, here is a letter sent to you by my young cousin. I dare swear he loves you in his soul. Would you could hear sometimes what I see daily. Sighs and tears, as if his breast were a prison to his heart.
Receive it, Annabella.
Alas, good man.
What's that she said?
And please you, madame, she said, alas, good man. Truly, I do commend him to her every night before her first sleep, because I would have a dream of him, and she seems to hearken to that most religiously.
Sayst so? God a mercy, Peutona. Here is something for thee, and prithee, do what thou canst on his behalf. It shall not be lost labour. Take my word for it.
Thank you most heartily, madame. Now I have a feeling of your mind. Let me alone to work.
Guardian!
Did you call?
Keep this letter.
Signor Florio, in any case, bid her read it instantly.
Keep it for what, pray? Read it me here. Right.
I shall, sir.
How do you find her inclined, signor?
Truth, madame, I know not how. Not all so well as I could wish.
Madame, I am bound to rest your cousin's debtor. The jewel, I'll return, for if he love, I'll count that love a jewel.
Mark you that? Nay, keep them both, sweet maid.
You must excuse me. Indeed, I will not keep it.
Where's the ring? That which your mother in her will bequeathed and charged you on her blessing to give to none but your husband. Send back that.
Well, I have it not.
Have it not? Where is it?
My brother in the morning took it from me, said he would wear it today.
Well, what say you to Bajetto's love? Are you content to match with him? Speak.
There is the point indeed.
What shall I do? I must say something.
Say
say something. Why do you not speak?
Sir, with your leave, please you give me freedom.
Yes, you have it.
Madame Donardo, if your nephew means to raise his fortunes in his match, the hopes of me will only hinder such a hope. Madame, if you love him, as I know you do, find one more worthy of his choice than me. In short, I am sure I shall not be his wife.
Why, he is plain dealing. I commend thee for it. And all the worst I wish thee is, heaven bless thee, your father yet and I shall still be friends, shall we not, Signor Florian?
Yes, why not? Look, here your cousin comes.
Oh, coxcomb, what do we get here?
Where's my aunt, sirs?
What news now?
Save you, aunt, save you! You must not think I come for nothing, masters. And how is it? What? You've read my letter? Ah, there, I tickled you! I say?
Twere better you tickle there another place.
Sirrah, sweetheart, I'll tell thee a jest and riddle what it is.
You say you'll tell me.
As I was walking just now in the street, I met a swaggering fellow would needs take the wall of me, and because he did thrust me, I very valiantly called him rogue, hereupon bade me sure. I told him I had more wit than so, and when he saw that I had not, did so bore me the hilt of his brazier, that my head sung whilst my feet came into the kennel.
Was ever the like I see?
And what did you all this while?
Laugh at him for a gull, until I saw the blood run about mine ears. Then a fellow with a broad beard, they say his new conductor, called me into his house and gave me a plaster. Look you, here it is. And, sirs, there was a young wench washed my face and hands most excellently. I faith I shall love her for as long as I live for it. Did she not, Poggio?
And kissed him too.
Why am I now you think I tell a lie, aunt, I warrant?
Would he that beat thy blood out of thy head had beaten some wit into it, for I fear thou never wilt have any.
Oh, aunt, but there was a wench would have done a man's heart good to have looked on her, and, oh, by this light, she had a face methinks worth 20 of you, Mistress Annabella.
Was ever such a fool born?
Oh, I'm glad she liked you, sir.
Are you so? By my troth, I thank you, forsooth.
Sure, it was the doctor's niece who was yesterday here with us.
Twas she.
Oh, how do you know that?
Why?
Simplicity!
Why does he not say so? If I should have said no, I should have given him the lie and deserved a dry beating. Oh, not of that.
A very modest, well-behaved young maid, as I have seen.
Is she indeed?
Indeed she is, if I have any judgment.
Well, sir, now you are free. You need not care for sending letters now. You are dismissed. Your mistress here will none of you.
No! Why, what care I for that? I get a wench's love in Parma for half a crown apiece, can I not, Poggio?
I'll warrant you, sir.
Signor Florio, I thank you for your free recourse you gave for my admittance. And to you, fair maid, the Jew, I will give.
Aye, marry will I, mistress. Farewell, mistress. I'll come again tomorrow. Farewell, mistress.
San Giovanni! Where have you been? What? Alone? Alone still. I would not have it so. You must forsake this overbookish humour. Well, your sister has shook the fool up.
T'was no match for her.
T'was no match indeed. I meant it nothing less. Soranzo is the only man I like. Look to him, Annabella. Come, 'tis supper time and it grows late.
Whose jewel is that?
Some sweetheart's.
So I think.
Madame Bernardo gave it to me to wear against my marriage.
Yes, but you shall not wear it. Send it him back again.
What? You're jealous?
You shall know anon. Welcome, sweet knight. The evening crowns the day.
Does my aunt think me a baby still, Portia? No, she shall know I have scots now.
Let's not bob you off like an ape with a knife.
Swart, I shall have the wench if she were 10 aunts, in despite of her nose, Portia.
Pulse is a grindstone, given not a jot of land, have she not promised you already?
True, Portia, and her uncle, the doctor, swore I should marry her.
He swore, I remember.
And I'll do it, for I tell thee, Portia. Did see the codpiece point that you gave me, and the box of marmalade.
I kissed you too, at my chops, watered at the sight of it. You have no choice but to clap up a marriage and hug a mother.
And I'll do it, for I tell thee, Portia, my courage begins to rise, and I begin to grow valiant, methinks.
Should you be afraid of your auntie?
Hang her, oh doting rascal! No, I say I shall have the wench. I'll begin to race wise men and constables, court whores at their own charges, and break the Duke's peace ere I have done myself. Come away.
My Lord Sir Anzo, although I must confess the proffers that are made me in marriage of my daughter have been great, yet the hope of your still rising honours prevail above all other jointures. Here she is. She knows my mind, speak for yourself to her. And you, daughter, see you use him nobly. For any private speech, I'll give you time. Come, son, and you'll rest. Let's away. Agree they as they may.
I thank you, sir.
Sister, be not all woman and think on me.
That's quick.
My lord.
Attend me without.
Is your will with me?
Do you not know what I should tell you?
Yes. You will say you love me.
And I will swear it too, will you believe it?
There's no point in faith.
Have you not the will to love?
Not you.
Whom then?
That is the fate of fair.
Of those I am regent now.
What mean you?
Oh, to live and die a maid!
Oh, that's unfit.
Here's one can say that's but a woman's note.
Did you but see my heart, then would you swear
it? Oh, that you were dead!
That's true, or somewhat near it.
See you these true love's tears?
No.
And now she winks.
They plead for your grace.
Yet nothing speak.
Oh, grant my suit.
What is it?
To let me live.
Take it.
It's still yours.
That is not mine to give.
One such another word will kill his hopes.
Mistress, to leave these fruitless shires of wit, I know I've loved you long and loved you truly. Not over what you have, but what you are, had drawn me on. Then let me not in vain still feel the rip of your chastity chain. I am sick, and sick to the heart.
Oh, help! Aquavitae!
What mean you?
Why, I thought you had been sick.
Do you mock my love?
There, sir, she was too nimble.
Tis plain. She laughs at me. These scornful taunts need to become your modesty or years.
Oh, you are no looking glass. Or if you were, I would dress my language by you.
I'm confirmed.
To put you out of doubt, my lord, methinks your common sense should make you understand that if I loved you or desired your love, somehow I should have given you better taste. But since since you are a nobleman, and one who would not wish to spend his youth in hope, let me advise you to forbear your suit and think I wish you well.
Is it you that speaks this?
Yes, myself. Yet know this, thus far I give you comfort. If mine eyes were to pick out a man amongst all those that sued to me to make a husband of, then you should have been that man. Let this suffice. Be noble in your secrecy and wise.
Why, now I see she loves me.
One word more. As ever a virtue lived in your mind, as ever noble causes were your guide, as ever you would have me know you love me, let not my father hear of by you. If I hereafter I must marry, then it shall be you or none.
Then I take that promise.
Oh, my head.
What's the matter? Not well?
I begin to sicken.
Help! Help! Put in there, ho! Look to your daughter, Señor Florio.
Hold her up! She swoons!
Oh, how are you?
Brother,
I'm sick. Convey her to bed instantly. I'll send for the physician right away.
My lord?
Oh, Vasquez. I am doubly Amandan, both in my presence and future hopes. She plainly told me she cannot love. And then upon Zuzigant, I fear her life's in danger.
My lady, sir, and so is yours, if you knew all. Alas, I'm sorry for that. Maybe perhaps it's but maid sickness. No flux of youth, if so, there's no present remedy than present marriage. But has she given her absolute denial?
She hath, and she hath not. I am full agreed with what she said. I'll tell you as we go.
Undone, utterly undone and shamed forever. Your sister, oh, your sister.
What of her?
What of her, for heaven's sake?
Was ever born to see this day.
She's not dead, is she?
Is she?
Dead? No! Tis worse. She is with child. You know what you have done. It's too late to repent now. Heaven forgive you. Heaven help us all.
Oh. How dost thou know she is with child?
How do I know it? Am I at all these years ignorant to the meanings of qualms and water pangs me, to changing of colours, queasiness of stomachs, pukings, and other things that I could name? Do not, for her and your sake, spend time in asking me how and which way it is so. She is quick upon my word, but if you let a physician see her waters, then you're undone.
But in which case is she?
She's prettily amended. It was a fit which I soon espied, but she must look often and forward.
Commend me to her, and let not the doctor visit her. Oh, I have a world of business in my head. How does this news perplex me? If my father visits, say, 'twas but some ill diet. Do you hear me, woman?
I will.
Look you to it.
I will, sir.
How did you find her, sir?
Indifferent well. I see no danger. Scarce perceive she's sick, but that she told me. She had lately eaten melons, and as she thought, those disagreed with her young stomach.
And did you give her aught?
An easy sufficient water, nothing else. You need not doubt her health. I rather think her illness is the fullness of her blood. You understand me?
I do. You counsel well. And once within these few days, she shall be married, ere she know the time.
Yet let not haste make unworthy choice, that word dishonor.
Master Doctor, no, I will not do so neither. In plain words, my Lord Saranzo is the man I mean.
Ah, a noble and virtuous gentleman.
As any is in Parma. But not far hence dwells Friar Bonaventura, once friar to my son. Now at her cell, I'll have them married.
You plotted wisely.
I'll send someone to speak with her tonight.
Saranzo's wise, he'll delay no time.
It shall be so.
Good peace be here and love.
Welcome, religious friar. You're one that still bring blessing to the place you come to.
Sir, with what speed I could, I did my best to draw forth this friar from her cell, so she may visit my sick sister and absolve her, whether she may live or die.
It was well done, Giovanni. Thou herein hast shown a Christian's care and a brother's love. Come, friar, I'll conduct you to her chamber, but one thing would entreat you.
Say on, sir.
I have a father's dear impression, and wish before I fall into my grave that I might see her married as 'tis fit. One word from you, grave friar, will win her more than all our best persuasions.
Gentle sir, all this I'll say, that heaven may prosper her.
Now, the doctor keep his word. Saranzo, 20-1. You miss your bride. I know 'tis an unnoble act and not becoming of a soldier's valour. In terms of love, where merit cannot sway, policy must. I am resolved. If this decision play not on both hands, then Saranzo falls.
You come this very night. Saranzo, 'tis ordained. Must be a fight to Annabella. For aught I know, married.
How?
Yet your patience. The place, 'tis Friar Benchura's cell. Now, I wish you to bestow the night in watching thereabouts. 'Tis but a night. If you miss now, tomorrow I'll know all.
Have you the poison?
Yes, 'tis here, doubt nothing. As you respect your life, be quick and sure.
I'll speed him.
Yes, yes, do away from here, for it is not safe. Ever my love.
On 9 to you.
Sir, if this hit, I'll laugh and hug revenge. For they dream of a wedding feast, but they will have chance to mourn the lusty bridegroom's ruin. But to my other business. Knees for notice!
Uncle!
Oh, my lovely niece, you have bethought you. Oh.
Yes, and as you counseled, fashion my heart to love him. But he swears tonight he will be married, for he fears his auntie else, if he should know the drift, will hinder all and call his costume shrift.
Tonight? Why, yes, best of all. Let me see. Yes, tomorrow we'll early to the friars. I've thought on it.
Uncle?
Lass, pretty lass, come, lass, lass. Poshio.
Welcome, my worthy cousin.
Have you not sweetmeats or dainty devices for me?
You shall have enough, sweetheart.
Sweetheart, mark that, Poshio. By my troth, I cannot choose but kiss thee once more for that word. Sweetheart,
Portia, I have a monstrous swelling above my stomach. Whatever shall it be?
I'll have physic for it, sir.
Time runs apace.
Time of blockhead.
Be ruled. Once we have done what's fit to do, you may kiss your fill and beg her too.
Sister weeping, I fear this friar's falsehood yet. I will call him.
Daughter, are you resolved?
Father, I am.
My lord Sir Anselm, here, give me your hand. And for that, I give you this.
Lady, say you so too.
I do, and vow to live with you and yours.
Timely resolved, my blessing rest on both. More to be done, you may perform it on the morning sun.
so back to kill someone.
Yeah,
I wouldn't have took the job.
You. I told you that, eh?
With this nice blood.
Thanks. Great listening. Great listening. I remember you keep talking about your head, and you'll feel, because you literally go like that, and we go, yeah, that's great. It's such a fine line between perfect and looks like a monkey shot it. Okay, such a fine line. You're doing
absolutely.
Really?
It's there.
Technically, that's what we're saying.
No, there's 8 average views, 8, but part of it is 8,500. With part of it.
So how many viewers are watching now?
How long is it?
Well, there's 8 computers logged on to it watching. How many, but we reckon, if they're showing it a lecture at Harvard, that could be X amount of people. But we've had altogether over 60 views.
How long's the football?
You've literally got 5 minutes.
Yep, it's 10 minutes. Really.
Enough time for me to have a cigarette. It doesn't go live without me being back in the gallery.
Is that girl smoking real cigarettes?
No.
No, that's why. I was looking at them now.
Yeah,
no, but
it
was
not the
men.
That
girl
was
smoking.
It gave off a smell as well. I was like, hang on.
It's not anything dodgy either.
That's what put me off. Because she started smoking. I was looking at everybody. Camera 1 to clip 2 instead. I was like, shit, 2. I was like, because I was looking at her smoking a cigarette. It put me off.
I'm not even halfway. You're going. I'm going back.
Yeah, well, I need to drink it off.
Is there another hour, 20 minutes?
Yeah, that's under hour and they've lost a minute off of that one. Yeah, so it's about the same length. But this speeds up and there's a lot of goriness and sword fights and things like that. So that needs to be cleaned up by a Matty, yeah?
Oh, yeah. I need to clean that one up.
Yeah? And then she gets her own garage here.
Yeah.
So that needs to clean up. And then you've got the table where she gets stabbed, which is here.
Before you get to the garage.
No, it's the other way around.
So, no, yeah. So I'm going to clean that up. Because I thought you cleaned
so
it up.
So what happens, right? That one, it comes out and mops that up. And then it kind of
Oh, right, because I've seen him mop something, and then I've seen the movie Mop as well, so I didn't know whether to do like those.
Yeah, and then when he comes over here, when they're on the table and they are, and she gets stabbed, it's just before the party scene. So he just comes on and does this and goes, and bends down and cleans it up, or they go, at him. So it's going to have to be like that.
That's how it goes. What would you do? Camera 3. And then I'll say, watch camera 1.
But that's all possible. I think it'd be fat. If you put yourself in the bag
there,
and the
bag's
next to
the
picture.
I only hear the reaction, and I saw where your camera was, and I was like, in general, you're giving a little bit too much headroom on most of your shots, okay? Yeah. It's fractional.
I'm not on a final night. Okay, Denise, how long? About 3 minutes, 4 minutes?
We've got a DSM at
the moment. Alright, well listen, I'm a very brief cigarette.
Channel 80. That's lovely, thank you, great.
Don't
take it out. Check it hasn't been knocked.
Thank you.
night as yet, and yet too soon to finish such a work. Here I will lie to listen who comes next.
We are almost at the place, I hope, sweetheart.
I hear them near, and heard one say, sweetheart, 'tis he. Now guide my hand some angry justice home to his bosom. Now have it, you sir!
Oh, help! Help! He is stitched for my gut! Oh, reflect daily quickly! Portia!
What ails him?
I am sure I cannot be his food and violence. Get that whip before and behind!
Alas, the villain he is slain, my lord!
Where is he? Slain, it cannot be. Are you sure you are hurt?
My belly seethes like a porridge pot. In cold water, I toil and rout. My whole body is in a sweat that you may wring my shirt dry. Feel here, why, Portia?
Alas, how do you?
Give me light.
Well, Senor's nephew, Bernardo's nephew, now is slain.
Follow the murder with all your haste, I beseech you. Tear off thy linen. What is wounds?
Ah! It's all this fine and blood. Nay, say goodnight with me. Portia, come out to my arm. Don't see it. Bid her for my sake. Make much of this wench. Ah! I'm going the wrong way, sure. My belly aches so.
Farewell. Oh, he's dead!
How? Dead?
He's dead indeed. 'Tis too late now to weep. Let's have him home. And with what speed we may find out the murderer.
Oh, my master! My master!
I saw.
And when is the marriage day?
Some 2 days, hence.
2 days? Why, man, I wish for 2 hours to send him to his last and lasting sleep in Vespers. I shall see I'll do it bravely.
I doubt not your wisdom, nor I trust you my secrecy. I'm infinitely yours.
I will be thine in spite of my disgrace. So soon. Oh, wicked man, I trust be sworn he laughed to see me weep.
And that is a villainous fault in him.
No, let him laugh. I'm armed in my resolve. Be thou still true?
I'm to gain little by treachery against so hopeful a preferment, as I am like to plight.
Even to my bosom basquets. Let my youth revel in these new pleasures, and if we thrive, he now has but a pair of days to live.
It is bootless now to shew yourself a child, Madame Donardo. What is done is done. Spend not the time in tears, but seek for justice.
I must confess somewhat I am at fault. If I had not twitched your nephew's love and my niece's. But as his fortune is, I grieve him as if he were mine own.
Alas. Poor creature. He meant no man harm. That I am sure of.
I believe that too, but stay. My masters, are you sure you saw the murderer pass by here?
To please you, sir, we saw a ruffian and a weapon all naked and bloody go and hide within the cardinal's gates, for with fear of their grace,
We thus go no further.
Know you what manner of man he was?
They say he is a Roman, and one that loved your daughter.
Grimaldi. On my life.
Aye, aye. 'Tis him for certain.
The friar is justable. She will no doubt give true justice.
Knock someone at the gate.
I'll lock, madame.
We require speech about some urgent business.
Why, how now, friends? What saucy mates are you that know nor duty nor civility? Are we a person fit to be your host, or has our house become your common into? Beat our doors at pleasure. What such haste is yours as that it cannot wait fit times? Are you the masters of this commonwealth and know no more discretion? Oh, your news is here before you. You have lost a nephew, Donardo, last night by Grimaldi slain. Is that your business? Well, we have knowledge on't let that suffice.
In presence of your grace, in thought, I never meant Pichetto any harm, but Florio, you can tell with how much scorn Soranzo, backed by his confederates, hath often wronged me. I, to be revenged. For that I could but else win him, that fight of thought, by way of ambush, to have him killed, but was unluckily there in the stook. Else he had felt what late Pichetto did. Yet, humbly, I submit me to your grace, to do with me as you please.
Rise! Grimaldi! You citizens of Parma know, as nuncio from the Pope, for this offence I hereby receive Grimaldi into His Holiness's protection. Oh, he is no common man, but nobly born of prince's blood. Although you, Sir Florian, thought him too mean a husband for your daughter, if more you seek, he must go to Rome, for he shall thither learn more wit for shame. Bury your dead. Away, Grimaldi. Leave him. Is this the church's voice? Dwells justice here?
Justice has fled to heaven and comes no nearer. Soranzo, was for him? Oh, impudence! I see the face to speak and feel no shame! Come, Donardo, come! There's no help in this when cardinals think murder's not amiss. Great men may do their wills, we must obey! But heaven will judge them for it another day.
For me against my death, and so much more to bless me, hath enriched my life with his most precious jewel. Such a prize as earth hath nothing other like to this. Cheer up, my love. And gentlemen, my friends, rejoice with me amid
This day will come unless he comes to Annabella's hell!
Annabella's hell!
Torture. Ere I'd endure this sight to see my love clipped by another, I'd dare confusion and stand the horror of 10,000 deaths.
Are you not well, sir?
Prithee, fellow, I need not thy officious diligence. Come, Donato, and get your late mishaps. Drown your cares in wine.
Vasquez.
My lord.
Reach me that. Here, brother Giovanni, here's to you. Your turn comes next. Thou now a bachelor. Here's your sister's happiness. And mine.
I cannot drink.
What?
T'will indeed offend me.
Pray, do not urge him if he be not willing.
How now? What noise is this?
No, oh, I forgot to tell you. A certain young maiden of Parma, in honor of Lady Annabella's marriage, has sent her love in a mask. For which she humbly requires your patience and silence.
Ah, we must bow to her, and so much the more, as it comes unexpected. Guide them in.
Amaze nor blush, young lovely bride. I come not to defraud you of your man. 'Tis now no time to reckon upon the talk of what palm hath long rumoured of us both. The breath that vents it will like a bubble break itself at the last. But now to you, sweet creature, lend me your hand. Perhaps it has been said that I claim some interest in Sanzo, now your lord. But what I have the right to do, his soul knows best. And in my duty to you, your noble worth, and my care to you, sweet Annabella, here, take this hand from me. I'll once more join by what the Holy Church has finished. And aloud, have I done well?
You have too much engaged us.
One more thing, that you may know my single charity freely. I here remit all interest I here could claim and give you back your vows. To confirm it, reach me a cup of wine. Look to it, Vasquez.
Fear nothing.
Hippolyta, I thank you. And a pleasure's happy union as another lamp. Wine there.
You shall have not, nor shall you pledge her.
How?
No, no, Mistress She-Devil. Your own mischievous treachery hath killed you. I must not marry you.
Villain!
Troposphering gone. By vapor of the sea, thou art but dead. If thou hast any grace left, pray.
Monster!
Tis true. I feel my minute coming.
And that's the end, Captain! So vile a creature.
Here's the end to last and pride.
It is a fearful sight.
Vasquez, now I know thee a trusty servant and will never forget thee. Come, my love, we'll home and thank this heaven for this escape. Father and friends, we must break up this myth. It has been too sad a feast.
Barney, and take heed. I fear the event that marriage seldom is good, when the bride's banquet so begins in blood.
My wretched wife, more wretched in her shame than in her wrongs to me. She hath paid too soon for the forfeit of her modesty and life. And I am sure, my lovely niece, though vengeance hover, keeping aloof yet from Sir Anzo's fall, yet he will fall and sink with his own weight. For as I hear, debates already twixt his wife and him thicken and run to head, for she slightens his love, and he abandons hers. Much talk I hear. Since things go thus, my lovely niece, in tender love and pity of your youth, my counsel is that you hie to fair Cremona, there to vow your soul in holiness, a holy votaress. For no life is blessed but the way to heaven.
Uncle, shall I resolve to become a nun?
Aye, gentle niece, aye. And in your hourly prayers, remember me, your poor unhappy hie to Cremona now as fortune leads, your home
your cloister, your friends, your beads, your chest, and single life shall crown your birth. For who dies a virgin lives a saint on earth.
Then farewell, world and worldly thoughts. Adieu. Welcome, chaste bell. Myself, I yield to you.
Fate's already twixt his wife and him. Dickenham runs ahead, for she slightens his love, and he abandons hers. Much talk I hear. Enough, and more than enough, of improbability would perhaps remain, even in the arrangement recommended in a former page. But the most glaring part of it would be certainly weakened or removed by the change.
Don't strop it! Famous whore! Where every drop of blood that runs in thy adulterous veins alive. This sword, doth see it shall in one blow compound them all. Harlot! Rare, notable harlot! That with thy brazing face maintains thy sin was a no man in Parma to be bought to your loose cunning whoredom else but I. Must your heart itch, glorious of lust, the heyday of your luxury, be fed up to the servant? And could none but I be picked out to be cloaked to your close tricks? Your belly sports! Now I must be the that to all that calamity thy stuff in thy corrupt the bastard bearing wound. Why must I?
Ah!
was he called?
We are not come to that. Let it suffice that you should have the glory to father what so brave a father got. In brief, had this chance not fallen out as it doth, I had never been troubled with the thought that you had been a creature but for marriage. Oh, I scarce dream of that yet.
Tell me his name.
Alas! Alas, there's all! Will you believe?
What?
You shall never know!
How?
If you do, let me cursed.
Not knowing this trumpet. I will spare thy life.
My life? I will not buy my life so dear.
I will not slacken my vengeance. Forbear, Vasquez. A damned whore deserves no pity.
Now the court of Fender, would you be recognized? You're a traitor to most of men like she is your wife.
What fault she's done before she married you, we're not against you.
Alas, what has she committed, which any lady in Italy in like case will not?
So be ruled by your respect and not your fury, too inhumane and beastly.
She shall not live!
And will you ever confess to your offer her current misfortunes? I warn you, it is an unconscionable demand. She should lose the estimation that I, for my part, hold her worth. Sir, if she had, then you must not. Of all men living, I know, be reconciled, sir. Alas, a good gentlewoman.
Bitch! Do not beg for me! I prize my life as nothing! If the man will needs be mad, why let him take it!
Vasquez here has sold
this! Yes! And I commend her for it. In this she shows the nobleness of a galleon spirit to beshrews my heart. But it becomes her rarely, sir. In any case, come on your revenge. Now, the sentence of your wrongs to me. Be ruled by respect and honour, you will mar all. Sir, if my years of service are ever any credit to you, be not so violent in your distractions. Think of what triumph this news may bring those neglected suitors. It is as manlike to bear extremities as godlike to forgive.
Oh, Vasquez, Vasquez, in this piece of flesh, the faceless face of hers, had I laid up the treasure of my heart, hadst thou been virtuous, fair wicked woman! Not the master's choice of life itself had made me wish to live with anything but thee, deceitful creature. Hadst thou mocked my hopes, and in the shame of thy lewd wound even buried me alive, oh, I did too dearly love thee.
It is well, sir, be brief and moving. It is for the purpose.
Be witness to my words, thy soul and thought, and it is not think that in my heart I did too superstitiously adore thee.
I must confess, I know you love me well.
And wouldst thou use me thus? Oh, Annabella, be thou assured, whoever the villain was that thus attended thee to this disgrace, well, in my lust, would never love like me. He doted on the picture that hung upon thy cheek and then pleaded on his humorous eye on the part I loved, which was thy heart. And as I thought thy virtues.
Oh, my lord, these words prove deeper than your thought could do.
Let me not ever take comfort, but I begin to weep myself. So much do I pity him, I knew when his rage was overpassed what it would come to.
Forgive me, Annabella, though thy youth attempted above thy strength to folly. Yet, will I not forget what I should be and what I am, a husband? In that name is it divinity. If I do find that yet will be true, then here I remit all form of faults and all. Take thee to my bosom.
By my troth, this is a point of noble charity.
Sir, on my knees.
Rise up! You should not kneel. Go to your chamber, see you make no show of alteration. I'll be with you straight. Go tell my heart now. Go to your chamber.
So, this was somewhat to the matter. What do you think of heaven's happiness now, sir?
I carry hell about me. All my blood is fire with revenge.
That may well be, but know you how? Or whom? Alas, to marry a great gentlewoman, being made great to the stock of your hand is usual sport these days. But to know what ferret it was that hunted your cunning burrow, well, therein lies the cunning.
I'll make her tell herself all.
Or what? You must not do so, sir. Let me persuade your sufferance a while longer. Go to her. Use her mildly, if possible, to a voluntary, to a weeping tune. As for the rest, if all hit, I will not miss my mark. Sir, I beseech you go in. The next news I bring thee shall be of wonders.
Delaying vengeance gives a heavier blow.
His work for the nuns. I had suspicion of bad matter in my head a pretty while ago, as Madame Scurvily looks her at home. A waspish perverseness and loud fault-finding. Therein, I remember a proverb. Where hens crow and cocks hold their peace, there are sorry houses. Sfoot, if the lower part of a she-tailor's cunning can cover such a swelling in the stomach, I'll never blame a false stitch in my shoe whilst I live again. Up and up. So quick, and so quickly, too. To find Hoxie to learn by who. And here's the way.
Oh, Master!
What, cry?
crying, old mistress. Alas, alas, I cannot blame you. Ever, Lord, heaven help us, as mad as the devil himself.
Oh, there are parts in his day. Doesn't you see so too sometimes, Basquez?
Me? Well, he makes a dog of me. With some of my mind, I know what we would do. As sure as I'm an honest man, he would get near to kill my lady with unkindness. Say she be with child. Is that such a matter of a young woman of her years to be blamed for?
Alas, good heart, it is against her willful sore.
I dare say, all his rage is for she'll not confess whose it is, which he will know. And when he doth know it, I'm so well acquainted with his humour that he will forget all straight. I wish in plain terms she would just tell him, for this is the way indeed.
Does think so, Basquez?
Nay, I know it. If I did not win her by force, he was once of a mind you could tell. He planned to have wrung it out of you, but I somewhat pacified from that. Yet, sure you know a great deal.
I know a little, Basquez.
Why should you not? Who else should? On my conscience, she loves you dearly, and you would not betray her to any affection of the world.
Not for all world, by my faith and troth, Basquez.
Show pity on your life, if you would. In this, you both relieve her present discomfort, to pacify my lord, and gain yourself everlasting love and preferment.
Dost think so, Basquez?
Nay, I know it. I'm sure it was some near an entire friend.
'Twas a dear friend indeed, but...
But what? Fear not to name him, my life between you and danger. I'm sure it was no base fellow.
Will thou stand between me and harm?
You'd pity what else? And you should be rewarded too. Trust me.
'Twas even no worse than... than her own brother, Basquez.
Her brother Giovanni, I warrant you.
Even he, as ever a brave gentleman kissed a fair lady, oh, they love most perpetually.
A brave gentleman indeed. Why, therein I commend her choice. Better and better. You sure 'twas he?
Sure. And you shall see he'll not be far from her too.
You were to blame if he would. But might I believe thee?
Believe me? Why dost thou think I'm a Turk or a Jew? Basquez, I have known their dealings too long to belie them now. I don't know what it means.
You shall know presently. Thou prate, thou toad-bellied bitch.
Why, this is excellent, and beyond expectation. Her own brother. To what heights of damnation have the devil himself trained our age to? Her own brother. This is yet the beginning. Fine, my lord, and choose from in these new points of revenge. Now I know, a soft tail goes beyond a soft tail. But what comes next? Giovanni. Why, my beliefs are strengthened.
Where is my sister?
Trouble with the new sickness, my lord. She's somewhat ill.
Taken too much of the flesh, I believe.
I dare say, my lord, and I do believe you've even hit it. But my virtuous lady.
Where is my sister?
In a room she lies. Pleases to visit her. She is alone. Your liberty have doubly made me your servant, and never shall, ever. My lord, I've made some of them fast enough. Have you dealt with my lady?
Gently, as thou hast counseled. My soul runs in a circle of sorrow and revenge, but Vasquez, he shall know.
Nay, I shall know no more. For now it comes your turn to know. Let my lord take time enough. Go at his leisure. He is sold to his death, and the devil himself shall not ransom him. Sir, I beseech your privacy.
No conquest can gain glory of my fear.
Farewell. And all ye thriftless minutes wherein false joys have spun, a weary
am to be believed now, sir? First marry a strumpet who cast herself upon you but to laugh at your horns, feast on your disgrace, riot in your vexations, cuckold in your brat. Bet. Waste your estate on panders and boars.
No more. I say no more.
A cuckold is a goodly tame beast, my lord.
I am resolved! Not another word! My thoughts are great and all as a resolute as thunder. In the meantime, I'll cause our lady to deck herself in the bridal robes. Kiss her and fold her gently in my arms. Be gone! Yet, hear you. Are you ready to ambush?
My lord, trouble not yourself in matters other than your own resolution.
All the cunning words thou canst. Invite the state of Parma to my birthday's feast. Haste to my brother's rival and his father. Entreat them gently, but not to bail. Be speedy and return.
Let not your pity betray you. Until my coming back, think only on incest and cuckoldery.
Revenge is all the ambition I aspire. To that I'll fall or climb. My blood is on fire.
Busy opinion is an idle fool. That as a school rod keeps a child in awe, frights the unexperienced temper of the mind. So did it me, who ere my precious sister was married, thought all taste of love would die in such a contract. But alas, I find no change in this pleasure, formal law of sports. She is one to me, and every kiss as sweet and delicious as the first. A life of pleasure is Elysium. Father, you enter on the jubilee of my retired delights. But I have found that the hell you have oft prompted is now telched but peevish chattering, and I can prove it too.
Thy blindness slays thee. Look, 'tis writ to thee.
From whom?
The blood is yet seething hot, which will anon be frozen harder than congealed coral. Why do you change colour, son?
For heaven, you make some petty devil factor twixt my love and your religion mask sorceries. Where had you this?
Thy conscience, ye seer, dost thou astute to warning?
Tis her hand. Tis written in her blood. She writes, I know not what. Death. She writes, we are discovered. Pox on fear with low faint-hearted cowardice, discovered the devil we are. Now, sir, what news bring you?
My lord, according to his yearly custom, keeping this day a feast in honor of his birthday, he by me invites you thither. Your most worthy father and the Pope's reverend nuncio and other magnificos of Parma have all promised their presence. Please you to be of the number.
Yes, tell him I dare come.
Dare come?
Yes, and once more tell him I will come.
These words are strange to me.
Sir, tell him I will come.
You will not miss.
Once more, sir, tell him I will come.
So I'll say my service to you.
You will not go, I trust.
Not go? For what?
Oh, do not go. This feast, I'll gauge my life, is but a plot to train you to your ruin. Be ruled, you shall not go.
Not go? Stud death, confounding armies with plagues, with hosts as hot as blazing stars. Not go? For I will go, for I resolve to strike as deep as in thy slaughter, for I will go.
Go where thou wilt. I see the while as thy fate draws to an end, to a bad, fearful end. I shall not stay to know thy fall. Well, youth, since no prayer can make thee safe, I leave thee to despair.
Despair. Or tortures as hot as a thousand hells,
All's one to me. I have set up my rest. But now, serious work on baneful plots. If, in my weighty fall, my understrokes should be crushed to splints, for me, they all shall perish.
You will not fail or shrink in the attempt.
Be sure, my lord. I'll be bloody enough, and as unmerciful as if I were preying on some rich booty on the mountains of Liguoria. As your reward, I trust none but my own pocket.
Here's gold. Here's more. One's nothing. What you do is noble and an act of brave revenge. The guests will come, Fasquets.
Yes. And now, let me edge a little of your resolution. You see, nothing is unready in this great work but a great man in you. Call your remembrance to your disgrace, your loss of honor, Hippolyta's blood. Arm your courage in your own wrongs so that you may best right those wrongs in vengeance you may truly call your own.
It is well. The less I speak and more I burn, and blood shall quench on that blame.
Now you begin to turn it out. Besides, when my young incest monger comes, he'll be so sharp set on his old bit. Let him have time enough. Let him have your chamber and bed at liberty. Let my hot hair have law ere he be hunted to his death.
It shall be so, and see, as we will wish he comes himself first. Welcome, my much loved brother. Now I perceive you honor me. You are welcome.
How's my sister?
Like a good housewife. Scarcely ready yet. You best walk to her chamber.
If you will.
I must expect my honorable friends, good brother. Get a fork.
You are busy, sir.
Even as the great devil himself would have it, let him go and glut himself on his own destruction. Hark, none so at hand. Ready to receive.
Friar, this grace hath made me proud that you forsake my house. I ever rest your humble servant for this most noble favor.
And we, your friend, His Holiness, shall understand how zealously you honor St. Peter's Vicar in his substitute. Our special love to you.
Señores, to you my welcome, and my ever better thanks for this most memorable courtesy. Please, for your grace, walk near.
My lord, we come to celebrate your feast with civil mirth, as ancient custom teacheth. We will go.
Attend the grace there. Señores, keep your away.
What hath changed so soon? Hath your new sprightly lord found tricks in night games that we could not in our simplicity? Is it so? Or does the fit come on you to prove more treacherous to your past vows and oaths?
Why should you jest at my calamity? Without all sense of the approaching danger you are in.
What? Dangers are half as great as thy revolt. Thou art faithless, sister. Else thou knowest any malice or treachery beside. Why I hold fate clasped in my fist and could commend time's eternal motion had I been one more thought ready than an ebbing sea. And what? You'll be honest now, and that's resolved?
Brother! Dear brother! Oh, know what I have been! And know that now there's but a dining time twixt us and our confusion. Let's not waste these precious hours in vain and useless speech. Alas, these gay attires were not put on but to some end. This sudden, solemn feast was not ordained to riot in expense. I that have now been chambered here, alone, barred of my guardian, or of any else, am not for nothing, and an instant freed to fresh access. Be not deceived, my brother. This banquet is a harbinger of death to you and me. Resolve yourself, it is, and be prepared to welcome it.
Well then, I hear the schoolmen teach that this globe of earth could be consumed to ashes in a minute.
So I have read too.
But 'twere somewhat strange to see the waters burn. Could I believe this, then maybe I could believe there might be a hell or heaven also.
That's most certain.
A dream. A dream! Else we shall know one another in this other world.
So we shall.
But do you think you look on me and may we kiss or prate or laugh or do as we do here?
I not know that. But brother, for the present, what do you mean to free yourself from danger? Some way think how to escape. I'm sure the guests will come.
Look up. Look here. What see you in my face?
Distraction and a troubled
conscience. Death! And a swift, repining wrath. Yet what see you in mine eyes?
Methinks you weep.
I do indeed. These are funeral tears shed on your grave. These furrowed up my cheeks when I first loved and knew not yet how to woo. Annabella, should I here repeat the story of my life, we might lose time. But be record, all spirits of the air, all things else that are, day and night, early and late. These tears which are her mourners now, but never till now did nature do her best to prize a more matchless beauty to this earth. Pray. Pray, my sister. Go thou, white in thy soul, and fill a throne full of innocence and sanctity in heaven. Pray, pray, Annabella.
Oh, then I see your trick. The blessed angels guide
you. So say I! Kiss me. If ever after times here of our fast-knit affections, though the laws of civil conscience may justly blame us, that they know not yet our loves, that will wipe away the rigour which in all other incests may be abhorred. Give me your hand. How sweetly life doth run through these precious veins. How constantly these palms do promise health. For Forgive me.
With my heart.
Farewell.
Will you be gone?
Be dark, bright sun, and make this deed more sooty than the poet's fame there sticks.
What means this?
To save thy fame, and to kill thee in a kiss. Reasons for it, even in thy death, for the dispute which created me to stagger in the act I most glory in. She's dead. Alas, good soul. This fruitful womb which hath received its life from me have had from me a cradle and a grave. I must not dally. This sad marriage bed, in all her best for her alive, dead. Soranzo, I see thy aim in this, thus preventing reaching thy plot. Annabella, how overglorious thou art in thy wounds, triumphing over infamy and hate. Shrink not, courageous hand, and stand up my heart, and act boldly in my last and greater part.
Wise and resolute.
Enough! My heart is fixed. Pleaseth your grace to taste these coarse confections
Though the use of such set entertainment is more consistent, cousin, than in course. Yet, friar, I am still made your servant by your presence.
And we your friend.
But where's my brother Giovanni?
Here!
Trimmed in weeping blood. Fate or all the powers could not prevent me.
What means this?
San Giovanni.
Shall I be forestalled?
Oh, be not amazed if your misgiving heart shrink at an idle sight, had you beheld the life and rape of beauty which I have acted. My sister. What of her? The glory of my deed darkened the midday sun, made noon as night. You came to feast, my lords, with dainty fare. I came to feast too. But I digged for my food in a much richer mine than gold or stone of any value balanced. 'Tis a heart, my lords, in which mine is entombed. Look well upon it, for you know it.
What strange riddle is this?
'Tis Annabella's heart. Oh, it is, I vow it so. That dagger's point ploughed up her fruitful womb and left me the fame of a most glorious executioner. Why, madman, art thyself? Yes, father, yes, list upon your ears and you will yield how much I have deserved to be your son. What is thou sayest? 9 months since I first thoroughly viewed and truly loved your daughter and my sister. Alas, my lord, he is a frantic madman.
Father, no!
For 9 months, I shared sweet Annabella's sheets in secret. For 9 months lived a happy monarch of me and her. This hand from her bosom hath ripped this heart and left her mother to a child unborn.
Incestuous villain!
His rage belies
him! It does not! That shall bear the fury! Bring the strumpet forth!
Oh, do, sir, have you no faith to credit yet my triumphs? I swear by all that you call sacred, by the loaf I bore my Annabella while she lived, that these hands from her bosom ripped that heart. Is it true or no, sir?
It is most strangely true.
Cursed man! Have I lived?
But I, guilt in the fair blood of a fair sister and a hapless father.
Inhuman scorn of men, how to our thought or live thy manners!
Yes, yes, I tell thee, yes, in my palms I bear the twists of life, Sir Anzo. See this heart, which was thy wife's. Thus I royally exchange it for thine.
Ah!
hold no longer. You, sir, have grown insolent in your butcheries.
Come. I am armed to meet thee.
That I have lived to see my wrongs revenge on the devil. Oh, Vasquez, to thy bosom, let me give my last of breath, and let not that lecher live.
Whose hand gave me this wound?
Mine, sir. I was your first man. Have you enough?
I thank thee, sir, for thou hast done what I would have done on myself. But art thou sure thy lord is dead?
As sure as I am to see thee done.
Think on thy life and end and call for mercy.
Mercy? Why? I have found it in this justice.
Strive yet to cry to heaven.
I bleed fast. Death, thou art a guest long looked for. Wherever I go, let me enjoy this grace freely to view my Annabella's face.
Raise up the city. We shall be murdered all.
You need not fear. You shall not. This strange task be unended. I have paid the duty to the son that I owe to the father.
Speak, wretched villain. What incarnate fiend hath led thee on to this?
In honesty, pity of my master's wrongs. For know now, my lord, I am by birth a Spaniard, brought forth this country in my youth by Lord Soranzo's father, whom whilst he lived, I served faithfully, and since whose death, I've been to this man what I was to him.
Say, fellow, knowest thou any yet unnamed counsel in this incest?
Yes, a young woman, sometimes guardian to this murdered lady.
And what's become of her?
Within this room she lies, whose eyes, after her confession, I caused to be put out, but kept alive to confirm what Giovanni's own mouth you've heard. what I have done you may judge of, and let your wisdom be the judge of your reason.
First this woman chief in these effects, my sentence forthwith that she be taken out of the city, there to be burnt to ashes.
It is most just.
Be it your charge, Zinardo. See it done.
I shall.
And what for me? If death, 'tis welcome.
Fellow, since what thou didst was not done for thyself, being no Italian, I banish thee forever to depart within 3 days. In this we do dispense on grounds of reason, not of thine offence.
'Tis well. This conquest is mine, and I rejoice that a Spaniard outwent an Italian in revenge.
Take up these slaughtered bodies and see them buried, and disperse all the gold and jewels by the canons of the church. We seize upon to the Pope's proper use.
Your Grace's pardon. Thus long I've lived disguised, to see the effects of lust and pride both be brought to just balance.
What? Richard Detto, whom he thought for dead?
Sir? Was it you?
Your friend.
We shall have time to talk at large of all. But never yet incest and murder have so strangely met of one so young, so rich in nature's store. Well, who could not say, 'tis pity she's a whore.
Thank you.